Hi everyone, my name is Claire Tomlin, and this is module 20 of a series of modules that we're developing for the course EECS 221A at Berkeley, and I'm a professor in EECS at Berkeley. The topic of this module is Jacobian linearization. So we've been talking a lot about linear systems, about linear models, and so it's nice to take a step back and ask, how do you come about getting these models? So we just spent in the previous module time talking about the system x dot is equal to a of t x plus b of t u, where x is a state, u is an input to the system. We can think about circuit examples or mechanical systems or dynamic systems where we might be interested in coming up with such a module, where we recognize the states as positions and velocities responding to inputs, which are some kind of perturbation that you can apply to the system. Yet typically, models that we derive using physics are nonlinear models. They're not necessarily linear in the state and in the input. What we would like to think about is, suppose we're given a nonlinear model, how might we develop an approximation of that model which is linear? And one way to do that is through Jacobian linearization, where we compute the linear, we compute the matrices, the A of t and B of t, and then in the output equation, C of t and D of t matrices, through computing a Jacobian. So let's talk about that. Let's derive it generally and do an example. So suppose we start with a general system. It could be nonlinear. So here, again, x is the state. Let's give it an input, u, and it could be possibly time varying. So here we've got some initial condition as well. And we can see that the linear systems that we've been working with so far, they fall into this category. They're a special case of this category where f of x u is equal to a of x plus b, a times x plus b times u. Okay, so what is Jacobian linearization? Well, let's consider the following. Suppose that you looked at the system and you applied an initial, or let's call it some kind of nominal input. So a nominal input u, and I'm going to use superscript 0 to indicate the nominal input. It's a function, so it's applied over a time horizon relative to that system. And suppose if you apply that input u, you end up with some solution to that differential equation. Again, it's going to be a function over the time horizon of interest. Okay, so you apply that input u, and you, if you could solve that differential equation, you would get the nominal state trajectory x0. Okay, so now suppose we perturb u. So let's take u, and let's add to it some perturbation, which we'll call delta u. Delta u. So this delta u itself is a vector. It's a vector in the same dimension as u. So it's a function. It's written as a function. But at each point in time, this is a vector in Rni, the dimension of our input. Okay, so the idea is then, if we apply this perturbed input to the system, suppose that we results is a perturbation in the state, or a new state trajectory, which represents a perturbation away from the nominal, which is x, so the nominal solution, plus some perturbed state variable delta x. Okay, and let's also perturb the initial condition. So we're going to start at some initial condition, which is x0 plus delta x0. Okay, so this represents the perturbation on the input, the perturbation on the state, and the perturbation on the initial state. All right, so can we compute, and this is really what Jacobian linearization is doing, can we compute the dynamics of the perturbation? So we'd like to consider a new state variable, which is the perturbation away from the nominal, and can we compute how that perturbation depends on the perturbation in u and the perturbation in the initial state? And so that's what we'll do. So what do we know from this? From the fact that the nominal results in a nominal state, we know that the nominal trajectory solves the following differential equation, u, t. So we know that that's true. And then we also know the initial state is given by, so at the nominal, it's given by x0. Okay, so that's our nominal case here. And we can do the same for the perturbed case. So let's write that down here. X perturbed, so that's plus perturbation, nominal plus perturbation. And so we'll write the derivative of those. We'll bring the derivative inside. Is going to be f of x plus the perturbation u nominal plus the perturbation in u t. And then similarly, the initial state, so x initial, the nominal value plus the initial state at time t0 should be x0 plus delta x0. So this should actually be, no, that's fine, x0, the value of the nominal trajectory at the initial time. Okay, so now if we look at that right-hand side, we can perform a Taylor series expansion of f around that nominal value x superscript 0 and u superscript 0. And so we can do that. So f of x superscript 0 plus delta x comma u nominal plus delta u t is equal to the value of f at the nominal plus the change in f due to the perturbation. And so that's given by dx of f of x u t evaluated at the nominal times delta x, the perturbation in x, plus the perturbation in u, plus d by du f of x u t evaluated at the nominal times the perturbation in u. Plus higher order terms. So these represent the first terms of the Taylor series expansion, but then we would have terms that depend on df by dx squared, du by df by du squared, cross terms, df by dx, du, etc. So I'm going to lump all of those higher order terms into something called higher order terms. And so that's an equality if I compute all of these higher order terms. Okay, so what are these terms here? Well, this is the derivative of a vector-valued function. Remember, f is a vector-valued function. There's n components to it. With respect to a state, which is n-dimensional. So this represents the Jacobian of f, the derivative of f with respect to x. It's an n by n matrix whose first row is d f1 represents the first component of f, so df1 by dx1, df1 by dx2, up to dfn by dxn. And then the last row of that would be dfn by dx1 up to dfn by dxn. Similarly, this represents the Jacobian of f with respect to the input. So again, it's the derivative of a vector-valued function in Rn with respect to an input vector which is of dimension r, which is of dimension ni. So it's in Rni. So this represents an n by ni dimensional matrix, and the terms in the matrix would comply with the standard Jacobian. Okay, so this is equal to x plus dx derivative. So that's what this is here. But we know that this equation holds. So we know that this is equal to this term here. And what we end up on the left-hand side with on the left-hand side is just the derivative of delta x, the derivative of the state perturbation. And on the right-hand side, we have this matrix times delta x plus this matrix times delta u. So it's starting to look familiar, back to our standard linear system, if we ignore these higher order terms. And so when we perform Jacobian linearization, the approximation that we're doing is assuming that those higher order terms are zero. So they're terms that involve these higher order derivatives of these functions, yet they're going to involve terms like delta x squared, delta x, delta u squared. And if delta x and delta u are small, then it's probably a good approximation that these higher order terms are very small and we can ignore them. But it's not always a good approximation. And that's when we have to be careful, when we're thinking about a very highly nonlinear system in which small perturbations in U might not result in small perturbations in X. Okay, so it's not always a good approximation, but it's typically a good approximation if you're perturbing the system, if the system is almost linear, or you're performing small perturbations on the system. Okay, so let's wrap up by just reflecting where we are here. So let's write this up at the top. So what we have is a new differential equation where our state is the perturbation delta x. So that's equal to, and I'm going to call this, so I've called it d by dx here. So x represents the first argument of the function f. So often you'll see this notation, d sub 1 of f, which means the derivative of f with respect to its first variable x. And that's evaluated at the nominal times delta x plus d sub 2 of f, the derivative of f with respect to u, evaluated at the nominal times delta u. And so this equality is, again, it's an approximation, assuming that these higher order terms are 0. All right, so what is this? This is an n by n matrix. So this is what we'll call our A of t. And this is an n by n I dimensional matrix. So we'll call this B of t. And so we're back to the linear equation, where the linear equation is in a state variable which represents the perturbation. If we had an output equation, so we started out with a state update equation, which was x dot is equal to f of x u. If we had an output equation, say y is equal to h of x u t, again, nonlinear function, possibly nonlinear function of the state and input, we could perform the same kind of Jacobian linearization on h to come up with the linearized form. So the perturbation in y is equal to some matrix C of t, which is computed from the Jacobian of this with respect to x, times delta x plus a term d of t, which is the Jacobian of h with respect to u, times delta u. Okay, so we end up with C of t, x of t, plus d of t. So that's delta x of t, delta u of t. All right, let's finish with a quick example. This is a simple example, but it illustrates nicely what we've done. Suppose we had an inverted pendulum system. So here's an example. This is a pivot point, and it's a planar pendulum. So it's attached at the pivot, and it's just rotating back and forth in the plane. So we'll call the zero angle the vertical, because we'd like it to actually stand up in an inverted way. That should be a straight pendulum. And this is its pivot point. We'll have some torque, apply some torque around the pivot point. Let's call the angle with respect to the vertical theta. And this will be some mass, and the pendulum will have length L. Okay, so we can derive the equations of motion of this system. And if we do that, we get ml squared theta double dot minus mgl sine theta is equal to the applied torque at the pivot tau. Okay, well, if we wanted to perform Jacobian linearization on this, so we would first of all think about what the state variables might be. We have theta appearing, we have theta double dot appearing. So let's let our first state variable x1 be theta, and let's let our second variable x2 be theta dot. And therefore, we can represent this differential equation in terms of a first order vector differential equation in x1 and x2. So it's going to be ml squared x2 dot minus mgl sine x1 is equal to tau. And so the system is nonlinear in the state because of that sinusoid there. The state appears through a nonlinear function, which is that sinusoid. Okay, now typically what we would do here, we wouldn't go through the whole Jacobian linearization. We would just say, let's do a small angle approximation. If theta is small, then sine theta is approximately equal to theta. Okay, so that's what our intuition says for the simple system. And if we perform Jacobian linearization, we should get exactly the same result because we're essentially doing the same thing. So if we look at the dynamics of this system, let's write out the vector differential equation. X1 dot is x2. X2 dot is equal to, so let's simplify and bring those terms onto the right-hand side, capital omega squared sine of x1 plus u, where we've simplified a bit here. So omega here is equal to the square root of g over l, and then I've normalized the input. So u here represents some normalized input, which is the torque divided by ml squared. Okay, so now let's perform Jacobian linearization. This is our function f on the right-hand side. So it's a vector-valued function in R2. And if we compute the Jacobian, so if we calculate now delta x dot, which is going to be delta x1 dot and delta x2 dot vector, that's going to be equal to a matrix, which will be a 2x2 matrix, times delta x plus a vector b times delta u. Okay, and then we compute this matrix just as the Jacobian, so let's do the linearization and plug in the nominal trajectory. So the nominal will just be the case in which the pendulum is pointing vertically. Okay, so the derivative of the first row with respect to x is just 0, 1, because it's x2. And the derivative of the second row with respect to x, so it doesn't depend on x2, so this is 0. And how does it depend on x1? So it's omega squared cosine of x1. But cosine of x1 evaluated at x1 is equal to 0 is just 1. So we get the omega squared term here. And then the dependence on u is just linear. So we get that result there. OK, so that just shows that then we end up with the same small angle model that we would get from our intuition, but we're performing it kind of in this principled way using Jacobian linearization. And of course, if we had a more complicated system where it wasn't so easy to think about small angle approximations, we would really need to do this Jacobian linearization to get to a linear form. Okay, so what we've shown in this module is, given a nonlinear system, how do we perform an approximation called a Jacobian linearization to derive a possibly time-varying linear system from linear approximation of that nonlinear system? And moreover, we've shown that the form of that system is the form that we've been dealing with. The derivative of the state is equal to a matrix times the state plus another matrix times the input. We've done the same with the output. And finally, the new state, so the Jacobian linearization, the state of the linearized system, we should always remember that that represents a perturbation away from the nominal, given that we're applying a perturbed input away from the nominal. So if the nominal is 0, like it was in this case, and the input nominal is also 0, then the state is the same as the perturbation. But often you're interested in linearizing around nominal trajectories which are not 0, which are some trim condition for aircraft, for example. So it's very important to take into account the fact that you've derived the meaning of your state variable in your input is different here. It represents a perturbation away from the nominal. Okay, thanks very much.